Peter, fire away.
This question's been percolating for some time, probably 3 years since I've read your book.
Okay.
And I'm an academic, and I love theology, like from my heart and knowing God. And I'm experiencing in reading and looking at the literature, reading your materials, and that the idea of theological anthropology, the idea of a perspective of personhood, well developed, and understanding how what it is that is essentially a person would be, if it would obviously take time, but if it was done right, it would include LGBTQ directly and would solve so much. And I'm thinking, and then let me mold into that. Some of the things you did in your book, where you're describing like what you did with Paul and Corinth and the problem there, that that there's a trajectory towards, and you even kind of talked about it this morning a little bit, a trajectory towards what's going to happen when we're all done.
Yep.
So I'm okay. Here's what's percolating then: the idea of the kingdom of God that comes into the culture, permeates it and changes it slowly, but also the way God works with us personally, I 3 years ago I wasn't on board with this, and look where I am now. Why not 3 years? You know, we get changed. So this theological anthropology that takes into account this reality that that male and female is not the essence, that orientation is a real part, important, but not the essence. The essence is something more that includes then all of us. That was way too much, but can you go somewhere with that?
Let me start by sharing a little bit about what I was into theologically before I wrote this book, because I think it speaks to your question. I've always been a New Testament scholar, but early on in my career, I was energized a lot by conversations with missiologists. And I became very interested in what happens when the gospel crosses cultural boundaries. And one of the things that the New Testament makes pretty clear in the Gentile mission is that when the gospel comes into a new cultural setting, they have questions that nobody asked before, because it's a new cultural context. And the old answers don't necessarily work. And I think that there are two things that are that always happen when missiology works right. One is there is an openness to those new sorts of questions. They're not ruled out of court because nobody ever thought of those questions before. But it's also the case that when we try to answer those questions, two things happen at the same time. Number one, we have to let go of some things that we thought were no-brainers before, so that the early church had to let go of circumcision and kosher as being universally what it means. You know, talking about theological anthropology, you know, you live in accordance with the basic structures of the universe, and that means you don't eat things that don't align with the basic structures of the universe. That's what kosher eating is all about, right? And so to say that that this is no longer obligatory is to change your theological anthropology, right? So you let go of certain things that way, but you also discover the heart of the gospel more clearly. And, you know, I think about Paul's incredibly important discussion of justification by grace through faith, which so deeply informs Christian faith now. It came as a result of this gospel crossing into a new Gentile setting and having to figure out what that meant. So on the one hand, certain things you let go of. On the other hand, there's a recentering on and a rediscovery at an even deeper level of what's at the heart of the gospel. And it seems to me that we ought to expect the LGBT conversation in the church to do both of those. You know, on the one hand, we may have to realize that the binaries with respect to sexuality that we've always assumed, just as, you know, at one point people assumed that lobster and shrimp, you know, were no good, some of those binaries have to go. And that produces anxiety for us the same way it produced anxiety for the early church. On the other hand, we discover the mystery of the depth of personhood at a more substantial level. And, you know, it does seem to me that I see both of these happening among LGBT Christians. And to me, it's one of the signs that there's something good happening here missiologically. And that's at least one of the frames that I would use to talk about it. Okay.
Well, this is, as we spoke out there earlier, this is my second time through, and I'm going to play a little bit of devil's advocate.
Because, okay.
Currently, my pastor and I are going through this book together, and he brought up some really good questions, and I'm like, oh, why not ask, you know, I'm going to see you know, the author of the book, and why not bring up these questions to him, right? so he's an academic as well. I'm not, and so I find myself very lacking. And one of the things that he brought up was first, was kind of when we talk about lust and desire. So my kind of theology is kind of shaped around kind of what you wrote in your book and kind of how you said, like, you know, this is what Philo wrote, and he brings up Philo as well, and he interprets it as there is an understanding in the ancient world that of consensual homosexual relationships, and that he also brings up I don't know exactly what, but he brought up the idea that there is a Greek ballad that emphasizes that they had an understanding. So I don't know if you can speak to that. How can he kind of more or less see that? And then I had a second question, which I'll bring up.
One of the distinctions that I make in the book, and I think a distinction that's important to make, is what we see in ancient Greek culture, and we're talking now about 500 or 600 years BC, the time of Plato and related stuff, and what's going on around the time that the New Testament was written, about 500 years later. That's one set of distinctions. Another set of distinctions has to do with what do Jews and Christians think over against Greco-Romans generally. And one of the things that seemed to me to be pretty evident in my research was that it may well be that certainly in the time of Plato, there were people, you know, I mean, the whole myth of the divided human beings in Plato's Aristophanes, where you have male-female pairs that are divided and they long to be reunited, and then you have male-male and female-female pairs, and this is the origin of people who want to be united with somebody of the same sex. You know, that's a well-cited. So clearly, there are these kinds of notions. What's interesting, however, is by the time you get to the New Testament period, in all the Jewish literature that I was able to find anywhere on this topic, I don't find that image ever appearing. In other words, it seems to me that Jews and the whole Jewish tradition is interpreting same-sex behavior in a somewhat different way than we find in Plato's Aristophanes. And what I try to argue in the book is when Paul uses all this language about lust and passion, that fits much more with the Jewish take, which is, you know, the Sodom and Gomorrah was the best farmland in the world sort of stuff, and these people weren't content and they wanted more and more and more, right? And that's the image within Jewish circles in particular that is used to interpret same-sex desire, not Plato's Aristophanes. So yes, this existed in the ancient world. I don't deny that. But it's diminishing in its significance in general in the New Testament period, and it's completely absent from any Jewish conversation. And when you think about it, it makes perfect sense that it would be absent, because Jews have a different doctrine of creation. They're not going to accept Plato's Aristophanes. That's fundamentally wrong from a Jewish perspective. So anybody who's coming out of that tradition just isn't going to buy that, and they're operating with a different framework.
My second question with regards to Romans 1 and then talking about lesbian relationships, or that reading and interpretation of lesbian relationships. So his argument would be, to him it's very evident that what it refers to is lesbian relationships, and that's how it's translated from it's Greek into modern day. How would you kind of pursue that? I mean, I've read it. And
well, the most objective data about this is the fact, and I've looked very hard, and I haven't found any information that contradicts this to my knowledge, that for the first 300 years of the church's life, nobody read Romans 1 as referring to lesbian sex. And there are multiple instances of this referring to women engaged in oral or anal sex, all right? So non-reproductive sex is sex that is contrary to nature. Now, I know that there are scholars who disagree with me, and affirming scholars who disagree with me. I'm not going to die on this hill, but the one objective fact is what may seem self-evident to us wasn't self-evident to anybody in the first 300 years of the church's life. And that ought to at least give us some caution about assuming that this is lesbians being spoken of here. The people who are linguistically the closest to the New Testament didn't read it that way. So, like I said, I'm not going to die on that hill, but I think we have to recognize that.
Hi, Dr. Brownson. In the Gospel of Mark, someone who's talking with Jesus says, "Lord, I want to believe, but help my unbelief."
Yep.
So my question is, for the people, and there are several of these people in my church, which is why I'm asking, for the people whose hearts have been changed, but their minds haven't been changed yet, that they're still kind of right at the beginning, kind of at zero, working through this new theology of LGBT inclusion, where do you start with them? If you were going to teach something first as far as scope and sequence, where would you start with people whose hearts have been changed, but their minds haven't been changed yet?
I think there's a couple of things that may be useful in that context. One is to help people to recognize that this is not a binary issue in terms of either you're affirming or non-affirming. There actually are a range of positions that sometimes people move through as they process this question more. And in particular, I think one of the things that people who are just beginning on this journey, one of the things to invite them into is what I call a more accommodating position. And if you're familiar, I cite this at several points in the book because I think it's a very interesting article. Lou Smeads, former ethics professor at Fuller Seminary out here in LA, Pasadena, in 1999, wrote an article called "Like the Wideness of the Sea." And it's an interesting piece because he uses the analogy of the way that his denomination dealt with the problem of remarriage after divorce. And he talked about how in the 60s, the early 60s, his denomination, which prior to that time, and believe me, I grew up in a town that had lots of CRC folks in it, and I saw this happen. If you got remarried after you were divorced, you were excommunicated from the church. And the only way that you could return to the Lord's table is one of two possibilities. Either you had to divorce your new spouse, right, which in itself is problematic, or you had to refuse from having sex with your spouse. Not a very popular option either. And so there were all these divorced and remarried couples who were not part of the church. And finally, what the denomination did was they said, you know, this is not what God intends, but we need to look at it through the lens of grace, and we need to offer forgiveness and reconciliation and invite these people to come to the Lord's table. And the denomination shifted in the 60s about that. Now, Smeads uses this to talk about LGBT inclusion. And he says right in the article, this may not be exactly what God intends, but the path of grace is to welcome these folks in that context, all right? Now, like I said, that's not where I'm at. That's not where I invite people to end up with. But oftentimes, it's a good place for them to start, you know? All right, you may not like this. We'll keep on talking about that for a long time. But in the meantime, can we look at these folks through the lens of grace? And I think a lot of churches in particular, that's language that they understand. And even if they're not sure about the ethics of LGBT stuff, they know that it's appropriate to make exceptions when human beings are involved and when they've given their best efforts. And we're going to do that. Okay, and so sort of inviting positions like that as a starting point for people who are working is not the end, but it can be a starting point, and it is admittedly problematic, but you can help people understand the problems with it too, right? Sort of finding next step places to invite people to as they're in the process of changing, I think can be a helpful thing. Yeah.
So I'm actually one of those people trying to understand an affirming theology position. And to be transparent, I'm actually an employee of InterVarsity Christian Fellowship.
Okay.
So I guess the catalyst for me was, do I still have an employment or not? So this has forced me to really enter into trying to understand and not just read, but experience, and that's why I'm here, to experience affirming theology. And I'm a quarter of the way through your book, so I apologize if this is answered later in the book. But I wanted to ask this too, just because so far what I've read, what I've seen, what I've heard, the videos that I went to YouTube and just, I've been watching for days and for weeks now trying to revisit what I've grown up believing, and it's brought a lot of healing and a lot of unanswered questions that I've had as well about certain passages. So my question is, and the reason I bring this up, there was actually a video where you were, you had a seminar and then you ended with, but you know, that has to do with the theology of marriage, which I'm going to get to in my later talk, and then the video ends, and so my question is, I know this is a very, it could be a very in-depth answer, but just briefly, if you can, state what is the theology of marriage, what's the purpose of sex, what did God want when he created this covenant of marriage, and if that's even possible to be able to answer. So that's kind of where I am right now.
Sure, good question, really good question. Let me just say something, first of all, about the whole InterVarsity controversy in particular, which I have to admit is sort of puzzling to me in a variety of ways. But I get anybody who's working with college students, you have to be able to articulate a coherent and meaningfully Christian sexual ethic, because that's what everybody is asking about. If you can't do that, you can't do college ministry. I get that. And I get that InterVarsity worries, at least some, I suspect, worry that if we if we adopt a kind of LGBT-affirming policy, what we're essentially saying is the only thing that matters is that sex is consensual. So at best you get a kind of serial monogamy, but you don't get lifelong covenant love, and that's not the Christian vision for sexual ethics, and so we got to stand against that. The irony is, I understand that and am very sympathetic to it. And that's really why I try to develop in the book this notion of the link between sex and kinship. Don't say with your body what you're not willing and able to say with the rest of your life, by living out a lifelong kinship bond. And I think this is at the heart of the biblical theology of marriage. It's my way of reading Genesis 1 and 2, that sex is meant to nurture and sustain a lifelong kinship bond. And so this is why any sort of promiscuity or even serial monogamy doesn't really fully express what the Bible is getting at when it comes to the meaning of marriage and the meaning of our sexuality. But on the other hand, if it is the case that sex is related to kinship, that's not gender specific. And it does seem to me it gives us, from a Christian perspective, an interesting way of interacting with all sorts of people, whether they're gay or straight. And there's all sorts of sexual experiences that I don't completely understand, but I think we can say to people, we can just ask people, what do you think you are saying with your body? You know, in your cultural context, what does that mean? And whatever it means, are you living that way in a consistent pattern? It does. And I've actually talked with a therapist who says this is an enormously helpful question in therapy. You know, because I'm not telling them what they should or shouldn't do. I'm simply inviting them into greater coherence and consistency, and it works, right? And it gets people moving toward more faithful and monogamous relationships. So I think for me, that's at the core of what I would call a theology of monogamy, right? That this is why theologically marriage really needs to be monogamous. And I think despite the fact that there's polygamy in scripture, I think the arc of the narrative is moving towards monogamy. And that's the framework within which we need to understand that. Then the other piece theologically is the way in which the prophetic tradition makes this point of contact between marital love and covenantal love. That there's a way in which the most intimate and deepest human bonds that we experience point to and reflect and draw something from divine love for human beings. And whatever we think about marriage, we have to think about it in a way that emphasizes that and invites that linkage and invites people to look at themselves that way. So those would be at least two things I would want to say.
I read your book, Dr. Brownson, really loved it. It was very eye-opening to me. Somebody here at the conference said, the more you learn, the more you realize you don't know.
Yep.
And so I think reading your book was part of that experience for me with some of these different categories that you brought up, with just kind of expanded my mind with things that I'd never thought about before. So I really appreciated that. My question is, since your book has been published, I'm wondering, I'm not personally aware, I'm wondering if you are, have there been, even in the field of scholarship, responses to your book that have sort of pressed that for you? Like, this person responding to my book, bringing this up, that's sort of a new concept that I hadn't thought about. Like, is there a way that responses to what you wrote have even expanded your understanding of this topic?
I've learned a lot. Let me say a couple of things. One has to do with Megan DeFranz's work that we heard from this morning. And quite honestly, I find her stuff on the image of God to sort of extend this conversation and to engage the whole Christian tradition in some really constructive ways that I'm not a systematician, I didn't do, and I think she has really added a lot. And, you know, some of what she had to say about eunuchs, I think, goes into a little bit more detail there. So there's a number of ways in which I think Megan has really contributed very significantly to the conversation, and other people as well. So that sort of on the constructive side. On the sort of critical side, on the one hand, I haven't seen anyone point to actual data. In terms of stuff from the ancient world that says, all right, I gotta revise what I said because I didn't take into consideration this data. I haven't seen that. On the other hand, since the book, I've been doing a lot of reading and reflecting about paradigm change. What is it that's involved in people changing the way that they look at things, and what I've come to realize is it's more complicated and less rational than I assumed when I wrote the book. I sort of assumed when I wrote the book that if I can make the cogent rational arguments, that everyone will simply say, okay, I'm convinced, and that doesn't happen. But some of the negative reviews that I've encountered, there is this subtext there that there's something else going on that really are hermeneutical issues and it's a paradigm shift that I'm inviting people to make in the book. And one of the things I've had to realize is not everybody is willing to make that paradigm shift, and that paradigm shift isn't easy for some people to make. To realize it's not just about evidence and argument. It's about other sorts of things as well. And I've had to come to grips with that, I think, at a deeper level. And if I ever write a second version of the book, that's probably more of the stuff that I would say more about.
I have not read your book, so I might be addressing something that's already in the book. But we talk a lot, and I've heard a lot of exposition of Genesis 1 and 2, but not 3. And my admittedly traditional white male understanding of Genesis 3 is that the relationship was broken with everything, not just between God and man or between Adam and Eve, but with creation, with our offspring, with everything. And I don't hear much about the brokenness of, I mean, I'm divorced because my sexuality is broken. I was unfaithful more than once. That's brokenness. And so I am struggling with you know, I don't want to be the guy with the big log in my eye and pointing out this little twigs, but I know everybody's broken, and I don't hear much about that. And I just wondered if chapter 3.
It is one of the things that I think, in hindsight, I might have said a bit more about in the book. One of the things that I say fairly often when I'm speaking about these issues is, it is not the case, from a Christian perspective, that a gay sexual orientation is inherently holy, any more than it's the case that a straight sexual orientation is inherently holy, because it isn't, right? You talk to any pastor, and you ask them, how many of the couples that you marry now have been living together as opposed to 10 or 15 years ago? And they will all say, a lot more, right? I read recently a statistic that said that if you look at women in their 20s and you ask how many of them are living with a significant other? And then you ask, how many of them are married to that significant other? You know what the percentage is? 52%. Right? So, in other words, of women in their 20s, only half have bought into, at this point, traditional marriage. Right? There's a lot of brokenness there. A lot of promiscuity, a lot of serial monogamy, a lot of things that aren't inherently holy. The key question, it seems to me, for both gay and straight people is not whether your sexual orientation is inherently holy. It's whether it is capable of being sanctified. That is, can it be drawn into the life of God in a way that bears fruit and reflects divine covenantal realities? And that's the point at which I think, you know, people who say the only way to be gay is to be celibate, you know, what they're essentially saying is this form of sexuality cannot be sanctified. It is always, not only is it wrong, it's incapable of being made right. And so, yes, I agree that our sexuality needs to be sanctified. It is not inherently holy. But the question is, can it be? And how can it be? That's the question, it seems to me, that the church is still dividing over to some extent.
I'm going to confess I have not read your book.
That's quite all right.
It's on my coffee
this
table.
This is not a requirement for this seminar.
It's on my coffee table with a stack of other books that I want to get to, but I'm really looking forward to it. First of all, I'll just state that I'm Roman Catholic by tradition and practice, and I have every hope that someday the Catholic Church will allow same-sex marriage. However, I'm looking at a very long possibility there. Anyway, but I do see over the years some changes in the thinking of the church, especially since Vatican II. Prior to that, marriage was always to be open to, you know, procreation. And then at Vatican II, they sort of gave a two-prong or two-fold understanding of marriage, which was, and they called it the two fonts of marriage, which was procreation or love of your spouse.
Yeah.
And I kind of see the opening for same-sex marriage as this love for your spouse.
Yep.
And I'm hoping that that'll continue to develop. So that's one thing. But I just wanted to ask you this question, and maybe I totally misunderstand my reading of Scripture, and that is, in the New Testament, it seems to me that God mandated a marriage that was not to be open to procreation at one point, and that would be Joseph and Mary. I want to know what you think about that.
The Catholic tradition in particular emphasizes the perpetual virginity of Mary. And so in that case, this is a marriage which was never open to procreation. It is an interesting problem. One of the things that I say in the book that I think is worth observing in this regard is that even the Catholic tradition didn't always use the language of open to procreation. And in fact, if you go back to the 3rd, 4th, 5th century, the language that they use is intending to procreate. The only sex that's legitimate sex is sex which intends to procreate. So, if you're a good Catholic and you're using the rhythm method and saying, all right, these are the times we have to have sex because this is when we're less likely to have babies, no, right? If you don't think it's likely to have babies, you shouldn't be having sex then. You should only have sex when the likelihood is the highest that you can have babies, all right? That was for hundreds of years the teaching of the Catholic tradition. And it's really only with the advent of birth control, when the Catholic Church said no to that, that it started to use this language of openness to procreation rather than intention to procreate. And I think they realized, intending to procreate will never sell, And it doesn't do justice to this unitive meaning of sexuality and marriage that the Catholic Church also recognizes. And so there, I think there are a variety of reasons why they did that. But it does seem to me that the whole tradition is more complicated in that way. I think while we're talking about the Catholic tradition, let me just mention one Catholic scholar that I met actually when I was working on my book. He came to Hope College, which is right across the street from the seminary where I teach. His name is James Allison. He's actually an ordained Catholic priest, works in South America. He's a Brit. If you want a kind of Catholic perspective of a gay Catholic priest, an out gay Catholic priest, who is wrestling with the whole Catholic tradition in a very tangible way, I would highly recommend his books. There's a lot of good stuff there that's worth pursuing. Alison, James Allison.
Dr. Brownson.
Okay.
So this is more of a church politics question, less of a theological question. I was born and baptized in the Reformed Church in America.
Yep.
And then I grew up and was a member for years of the Christian Reformed Church.
Mm-hmm.
The RCA has a number of gay-affirming gay-affirming congregations on the East Coast. As far as I know, there are none in the CRC. Mm-hmm. About 3 months ago, the CRC Synod essentially made a decision that the conversation is closed. There's not going to be any more conversation, even considering the possibility of gay-affirming theology. There are, as far as I know, no Reformed churches on the West Coast that are gay-affirming.
I think that's right.
As a result of that, and as a result of that decision about 3 months ago in the CRC, I had to leave the CRC, PCUSA now. I'm just curious if you see a future in either of those denominations of being you know, more gay-affirming than they currently are, or if you can even guess at what's going to happen.
I know less about the CRC and probably shouldn't comment about that. Some of you may know the Reformed Church of America, which is my denomination, had a very conservative General Synod this past summer. And the Synod recommended two changes to the Book of Church Order, which is the kind of rule book for the denomination. One of them specifies that it's the responsibility of the consistory to ensure that all the marriages in that church are between one man and one woman. Okay? The other one is they're recommending that a particular marriage liturgy, which has in it the line, marriage is the joyful covenanting between one man and one woman, they're recommending that to the classes, as the classes are the regional groups that are part of the denomination, as a constitutional liturgy that is part of the core liturgy. Now, the marriage liturgy has never been constitutional in the RCA. The big question right now is, will these pass? In order to pass, they have to be ratified. There's to be a positive vote by two-thirds of the classes, the geographic bodies. There are 46 of them in the RCA. There are two logical possibilities. One is that they will pass. The other is that they won't, right? If they do pass, then the more affirming churches are going to have a dilemma as to what they're going to do. I actually think in some ways it's a very close call and hard to make, but there's a decent possibility that they won't pass. And then there are a number of conservative churches who say, if we don't get our way on this, we're leaving. And so how many churches will leave will be the critical issue. The Reformed Church in America up to this point has never had anything that has that constitutional or official status on LGBT stuff at all. And that has created the capacity of the RCA to sort of live with its tensions. But that period may well be coming to an end. We don't know. Yeah.
This is a question regarding influence, influence from the perspective of the affirming argument. We're hearing it done academically. We're hearing it done through testimony. What do you think is the appropriateness of the either the office or the influence of the prophetic? And is there a legitimate giftedness in this conversation for the prophetic to be an influence? And maybe what would that look like?
Well, I think at one level, I would say if there is no prophetic element to this, it's probably not of God. Right? I mean, if the Spirit isn't at work doing something here, what are we messing with it at all? So yes, there has to be a prophetic element to it. Now, prophetic means different things to different people. For some people, it's just speak the truth. Who cares how people react, right? Your job is just to speak the truth. And I suspect, at least, when I read the Old Testament prophets, that's not the disposition that I find. You read Jeremiah. Jeremiah is agonizing constantly and experiencing deep suffering with what he has to say. And, you know, he recognizes this is not necessarily good news, and that grieves him enormously. So there isn't a kind of better than thou, high stakes position where you're simply talking down to people in a prophetic mode. I think when the Spirit is at work, there's always a sense of identification and partnership along with speaking the truth. So that's the one nuance that I would want to put on it. But if it's not prophetic, then how can you say that this is what God is doing at all?
I had a quick question about talking about Romans 1 and its reference to how you said that it might be referring to non-coital forms of sex.
Yes.
How does that kind of fall in line with maybe Song of Solomon that kind of extols maybe other forms of non-coital sex between like consenting partners, particularly like heterosex partners?
That's a good question. And I don't know enough about the specific sort of traditions of interpretation of the Song of Songs to give a highly nuanced answer. But it does seem to me that there is a somewhat different perspective in Romans. I mean, Romans 1 is really making the case for why the Gentiles are self-evidently alienated from God and in need of the gospel. Now, he's going to go on in chapter 2 to demonstrate why Jews are also alienated from God and in need of the gospel. So everybody needs the gospel, and then the gospel is the answer for everyone. That's the nature of his argument. So it seems to me that that's part of the reason why I think Paul is thinking of non-controversial expressions of over-the-top, self-centered sexuality. That's why I think Gaius Caligula is such a useful example, because everybody would agree, A, this guy was sexually voracious, and B, he was connected to idolatry. He's an example of everything that's wrong. And if he's the emperor, you know, he kind of represents everybody in that regard. So I think Paul is picking an extreme case, and so these nuances probably not on his radar at all.
I wanted to thank you again for coming out and for being such an advocate and to support all of us. I have a question, more of an advice question. I go to a church that they've known I'm gay for years now, and it didn't bother them because I was trying to be celibate for many years, and so it didn't really come up. And I just proposed to my girlfriend last week, and we haven't been back to my church since because we were here this weekend. So I guess my question is, with I know the condemnation that's going to come from our church and the people that aren't going to speak to us anymore and those kind of things, at what point do you stay at a church like that and maybe try to help them through it? And at what point do you, say, leave and go to another church that's more supportive? I know that Matthew, he's talked about in his book that he's left his church before, and I don't want to necessarily run from a good church, but I don't know how long I can go through that and kind of be set aside.
I can at least mention what I think are some important things to think about and to work on in this regard. In some churches, someone in your position is going to be put under discipline, right? And that's going to inject a whole set of issues that's going to magnify this sort of question. Other churches may be willing to take what I've called this more accommodative position. We don't like what you're doing, you don't necessarily buy it, but we believe that you're a Christian and you're welcome to continue here. That's going to make it a lot easier to think about staying in a context like that. So the way that people react and the boundaries that they create or don't create strike me as being very significant in terms of the sort of decision that you have to make. Because practically speaking, it seems to me, the question is, A, can I survive as a Christian here? And B, what's the possibility of having more productive conversations and dialogues? Now, on the other hand, let me just say that I have seen very tangibly the difference it makes when gay couples stay in a church. Let me tell you a story. This is a story about my own church. There was a gay couple that joined my church in the late 90s. And this was sort of controversial. The pastors said okay. They didn't consult with the congregation. Lots of people in the congregation weren't so sure. 3 years later, one of them, David, was nominated to become an elder in the church. And so there's a congregational meeting where they're going to vote on all of this. And it hit the fan. And the congregation had this long argument for like a half an hour, people standing up and saying yes and no and blah, blah, blah. Finally, David stood up and he said, "You guys aren't ready for this yet. And I'm going to withdraw my name under the condition that you spend the next year working on and studying this issue." Everybody breathed a huge sigh of relief. We got through the meeting and everything was fine. Now, 4 years later, he was nominated as an elder. He was elected, no problem. But fast forward 12 years, and my congregation was voting 2 years ago on whether it should become a Room for All congregation, which is an organization in the RCA that is explicit in its advocacy for LGBT folks. And three of the people, I was at all these congregation meetings, three of the people who got up and spoke at that meeting saying, yes, we should become a Room for All congregation. I remember 12 years before they were speaking against David being an elder in the church. What changed? They lived with Doug and Dave for 12 years. And that lived experience changed their minds, quite literally. And so it's just to say there is some advantage to hanging around and putting up with the crap, but you have to decide when the crap is too much.
Hi, Dr. Brownson. So first, I also want to thank you for your work. Huge fan. You know, I've I loved you for a few years. I'm having a tough time answering this question. I'm hoping you can help me. The original takes on Leviticus 18:22 and 20:13 that were affirming that I've heard were that, you know, it's about temple prostitution and about those things and against that. And so for me now, the interpretation that I'm hearing now is it's about the patriarchy and about treating a man like a woman and penetrating another man, a dominant ancient Israelite, you know. And so my question is, if that's the reason for it being condemned, we are still in a society that's very patriarchal. You know, there's just men, and that's why the fear still comes, is because you're treating a man like a woman. And so when you're a follower of Christ and you fall in love with Christ, you don't want to do anything that's going to dishonor anybody else. So it's a two-part question to you directly. Do you believe that there were LGBTQ people back in the day, IPA, sorry, I don't want to miss anybody, that were back in the day that existed, and if they were, they probably wouldn't culturally engage in a same-sex relationship. But if they did, if somehow they overrode their culture at the day, and would that be okay in God's eyes? Even if you took me in a time machine and put me back there, would that be okay in God's eyes? Because I want to please God. I don't care about the culture. I don't care about man. I want to please God. And if, in fact, he did say, Gilbert, in this time, no, you cannot. I will not allow that. Then why is it different today? And why is that something that lifted? Where in Scripture has that lifted?
First of all, let me just review a couple of things about Leviticus that I think are important. One is there is a striking absence of a reference to lesbian sexuality there. And what's particularly striking about it is it's immediately followed by the prohibition of sex with animals. And both men and women are forbidden to have sex with animals, right? This is sort of blurring the boundaries, and that's unacceptable. So it isn't the case that women are just ignored. They're not ignored, right in the text. But there's nothing about women's sex, which does raise, you know, this patriarchal sort of stream that's part of that. So I think, yeah, that is there. The other thing that's important to realize is that I suspect, at least, that one of the things that's operating in these texts is male-male sex is something the other nations do. Because there are themes in both of these passages about don't be like them. And so the assumption is that's a problem that the other nations have, and part of what we have to do is just not embrace this identity and these patterns of behavior that are part of the nations.
So would God be side B back in the day?
Well, now that let me get to that question now. I mean, first of all, I was just trying to untangle that. I guess I'm not sure it's possible to answer your question.
Oh.
And the reason is I don't think that we get in Scripture a kind of timeless revelation of the love of anything about God. It seems to me that Scripture portrays a way in which God acts in the world that I would call deeply incarnational. That God is always engaging with particular people in particular places at particular times and addressing what needs to be addressed there. And in this context, it's don't be like those pagan nations. You're asking a further question that I don't think the text is presupposing. And to pull it out of that historical context and try to make it universal doesn't work. Now, I do think that over time, as the gospel moves into different cultural settings, we learn more and more about what is culturally particular and what is transcultural. And what I think a lot of us here have been trying to argue is a more welcoming posture is a more transcultural posture, and these have to be understood as being more culturally particular. God doesn't do everything all at once, but over time we see the unfolding of God's purpose. So, you know, if you were to transport yourself back in time, it would be difficult. And I'm not sure I have an answer to that. But I'm not sure how you would transport yourself back in time either.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Dr. Brownson, okay. I am a United Methodist clergy ally with the joy and privilege of serving a long-time open and affirming congregation. Among the tools that you've offered, both through your book and in your talks today, have to do with sort of debunking the clobber passages, yeah. Which I found a helpful tool in my opportunity to serve my LGBT siblings. What I would be curious about are some additional tools for scriptural affirmation of same gender relationships. We've talked about in terms of especially intersex and our trans siblings, the story of the Ethiopian eunuch. I think about Acts 10 and 11, which you referenced earlier. I also think about David and Jonathan. But are there stories that we might lift up that are that we can use it as an additional tool to lift up and affirm our sexual minority siblings?
What is at stake here more broadly is a kind of what you might call a theology of intimacy. That is to say, what happens when people start dropping their guard and allowing relationships to get closer, allowing themselves to be more vulnerable? Because, you know, I mean, marriage is the sort of ultimate expression of this reality, but which occurs in a variety of ways and places. And it does seem to me that there are a variety of passages in Scripture that talk about this, that talk about these dynamics and offer wisdom and guidance. And there's a sense, I think, in which the whole emphasis on love as being sort of love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. The one who doesn't love doesn't know God, for God is love. You know, these are very strong affirmations, and they arise out of this experience, and that may occur in a variety of places, in a variety of contexts. It's not always sexualized. I mean, you talk to celibate communities, and they will talk about the importance of these realities for them, right? So it's not only about sexuality, but I think it does govern, it provides a framework for thinking about a whole bunch of relationships that seems to me to be pretty important.
Hi, how's it going?
Hi. Good.
Good. In my kind of research in working myself out, I did a lot of Google searches, a lot of looking at a lot of blogs, and trying to sort through the different arguments of, you know, affirming, non-affirming, and stuff like that. And I did come across one chapter or one thought that hasn't really been addressed, I don't think, in many of the books that I've read yet. And according to gaychristian101.com, there's talking about Jesus affirming a gay couple in Matthew 8 and Luke 7 about the centurion soldier. I felt it was a little bit of a stretch. I get how maybe the patriarchy of, like, you know, the him having his slave be that, and then assuming that's a relationship, but I just want to know what your thoughts were on that.
Yeah, the Greek word there is pais, P-A-I-S. And this word has a semantic range to it. It can refer just to a child. It can refer to a child who's a slave. It can also, in some context, refer to, you know, what Megan was talking about, these erotic slaves who had that particular relationship. The semantic range of the word does not require that. It's a possibility, not a self-evident way to interpret the word. So I, on the one hand, I think you have to say you can't exclude this as an option given the semantic range of the word. On the other hand, I think it's pushing the evidence maybe further than the evidence itself suggests to say that this is either what must be the way it's interpreted, or even this is the overwhelming likelihood of how it's interpreted. It's a possibility, but I would leave it at that.
Is it legitimate to have a hierarchy of values? Dr. Anderson talked about the Jews were being obedient when the Pharisee and the Levite passed by the bloodied man.
Yep.
We're being obedient. That's a good value. But the Samaritan man showed compassion, trumping those values.
Yep.
And Jesus said to the leper, if you are willing, not able, willing, you can heal me. And Jesus, filled with compassion, reached out and touched him and said, I am willing, be clean. Again, Jesus violating one guideline by trumping it with compassion. Is it fair for the church to say to ourselves, compassion trumps everything? Is there a hierarchy of values?
Absolutely. And I think you don't understand much of anything about the life and ministry of Jesus and the conflict that it produces if you don't see that, right? Jesus is accused of being the friend of tax collectors and sinners. If you're going to uphold righteousness, some people assume you have to shun these people. Well, Jesus says no. There are other values that need to be lived out besides simply upholding righteous standards. And I think the parable of the Good Samaritan is a classic example of this sort of thing. And it's what got Jesus into trouble with the religious authorities over and over again, was a disagreement about that hierarchy of values. So, that's clearly a part of things. The challenge, I think, that Christians face now is how to rearticulate that hierarchy of values in our context. And if there's a problem that some people on the more affirming side get into, it's one value gets singled out that trumps everything, like compassion. It seems to me that the picture is more complicated than that, too. Certainly, some values take precedence over others. Things like love, the New Testament says, have a kind of deep and abiding value. On the other hand, let's use an obvious example. Let's say a deeply loved man in the church is suddenly it becomes evident that he's incredibly promiscuous and is doing all sorts of damage. Now, people may have a lot of compassion on him, but you know, a church rightly would want to confront him with that and seek to bring about some sort of change, even if it's going to be painful. And there's good reason for that. Anytime you take only one value, you may miss some others that are important. So to say, yes, there is a hierarchy of value is not to say there's one that trumps everything all the time. It does seem to me you're still operating in a complex Christian context where you may have to decide in a particular context which value needs to be operative here. Okay, I got another one. I stirred some up.
you stirred up a question that I've had for a while. I'm a pastor and a part of a leadership team. And we get into this communication with people on the non-affirming side on a somewhat regular basis, more often than I'd like probably. And the question or the concern always comes up, and it seems to always be the same thing. It's kind of what you just touched on. It's that we're not confronting as leaders the sin in somebody's life. And it's always that sin in their minds, right? It's always that sin. And for some reason, when we try to make the argument that what about the sin of gluttony, or what about this sin, or what about that sin, it's like, well, yeah, we'll deal with those sins, and we do deal with those sins, but this is the one. So my question is, how do we better get into the conversation and, I don't know, make some progress?
one of the things I think that's part of this for pastoral leadership is what I talk about in my book is the difference between a bounded set and a centered set approach to ethics, right? A bounded set says there's this boundary and everything outside of the boundary is not okay. Everything inside the boundary is okay. And as long as you're inside the boundary, you're fine, okay? And this is the way a lot of people think about sexual ethics in particular. And everything outside the boundary of marriage between one man and one woman is not okay. Everything inside the boundary is okay. Now, the problem, of course, is that doesn't offer much guidance to married couples about how to improve their lives, right? We're just okay. There's nothing else. There's no meaning of sexuality. There's no deepening and growing that's possible in our sexual relationship. I mean, that's problematic, it seems to me. And what a centered set says is there are values that we always want to move toward, and anything that moves toward them is constructive. Anything that moves away from them is problematic, all right? So, for example, the connection between sex and kinship that I've tried to talk about is a centered set model. And so you ask people wherever they're at, what are you saying with your body? And is it consistent with what you're saying with the rest of your life? And how do you move toward that more? And that leads to, ultimately, to monogamy. But it's not everything outside of that is okay, not okay. Everything inside is okay. There is this unitive meaning of sexuality and marriage is the goal toward which all our behavior is directed. And it does seem to me that when you get people thinking that way, it can be a more constructive move. Lots of times when it's, this is a sin, the next question is, why is it a sin? What are the deep underlying values that constitute our identity and God's purposes for us that are being violated here? And then, of course, you're going to get into gender complementarity and all the other stuff. But then you're going to have a conversation about those issues. But as long as people aren't willing to have a conversation about why it's a sin, you're not going to get very far. So that strikes me as the next question.
So one of my favorite books is The Practice of the Presence of God. Mm-hmm. And that core theme that every moment of our lives we can spend in the Lord's company and he wants to spend every moment with us. One of the things that I'm presently struggling with is the realization that really, for most of my life, it was very difficult for me to imagine God keeping me company in my sexuality. It's one thing to think about him forgiving transgressions after the fact, to be in his presence as I'm wrestling with and processing scripture, talking to other people, but in the moment, particularly as a single person, thinking about, okay, God, will you be with me in my body in this moment? And that is not something that has totally gelled for me yet. And I guess I wonder, do you have a word to speak to that? Because, and one follow-up I would say is that as I chewed on this, there is no imagery or language that I can think of in scripture that works for me in this context.
I think what's at stake here is how do we think theologically about our sexuality apart from marriage, right? Because we're all talking with all sorts of people who aren't married, and they're sexual beings. They have sexual desires. They may have sexual experiences and practices. What the heck does all of that mean? Right? And yeah, I mean, we could talk a long time about that. But I go back to Genesis 2:18 as a starting point. Up until that point, everything that is created is good. And the first thing that is not good, the only thing at that point that is not good, is it's not good for the Adam to be alone. All right? I think what's operating with our sexuality, wherever we are at, married, single, gay, straight, or whatever, we're experiencing that tangibly in the fabric of our lives, that not goodness, that longing for something, some sense of connectedness to others that's deeper than we know now. And there may be a variety of ways to find that, but it does seem to me one at least starting point is to be able to name it, to just say, I experience a longing for connectedness with people that's beyond what I experience right now. And sexual desire, eroticism is all part of that as well. I don't want to minimize that, but this is one of the things that's lurking under it. And this desire to make oneself vulnerable, which is really what sex is, right? You take off your clothes, you're exposed, you're vulnerable, right? And to be vulnerable and to be loved is something that all of us long for and value. To be able to name those things and then to ask yourself, all right, what's appropriate ways for me to express that, to live that out now? What are inappropriate ways? May give a different sort of framework, a more integrative framework, when you kind of name the deeper desires that are operating there. And then you can ask, well, what's the best way for me to live these out here? So, at least to try.
I'm a mother of three children, and my husband and I have the privilege of having these three precious, young, loving people. We have the privilege of being able to do our best, like humbly just speak love into them and talk about LGBT affirmation in the church and in our lives. And so that's one thing. I'm also the director of children's ministry at our church. And so that is another great privilege to be able to spend time with these children. But I guess I don't really know how to open the conversation with the other children in our church about LGBT affirmation in our church. Our church, it's PCUSA. But it's also that this whole topic has been pretty quiet. It's not something that has been discussed a whole lot in our congregation. And so I just don't know how to approach that at this time. These children have so much love in them, and they're so full of compassion. I want to be able to speak to them at such an important time in their development, but I don't know how to do that with children. Mm-hmm.
Boy, that's a really good question. And there are aspects of it that I don't have a lot of expertise in and can't comment in detail. But a couple of things occur to me. Number one, I think with children, the more you can put a human face on things, the better. And it's a very different kind of conversation to say, did you know this about Mark, right? Rather than talking about it in the abstract. And I think particularly with younger children, that can be a more productive way to engage it, where you're talking about a specific individual that they know and can learn about or can react to. And you know, here are some larger things that the church is wondering about. So on the one hand, I think to make it personal makes a huge difference. On the other hand, it does seem to me that one of the complexities that you have to reckon with children is the developmental processes of their own gendered identity. And that's a reality. Children at different ages are doing different sorts of things, and it strikes me that you want to think really carefully about that At what age are we talking, and what are their developmental issues, and how should this intersect with whatever their developmental issues are at that particular point in their lives? And to make that sort of nuance and precision in the way that you're talking may also be a really useful thing. Hey, thanks for your patience, and it's been a pleasure to talk.